I didn't go into the situation in Afghanistan, but Afghanistan, the developments in Afghanistan affected Kashmir in 1992 when the war between the rival groups came to an end in April, and the ISI allowed Pakistanis and Afghans who had been involved in the Afghan jihad to come into Kashmir for the first time in December 1992. And this kind of thing could happen again. The other thing is, of course, China, which I did mention, which has great interests in the Gilgit part of the state. In the state itself, we've gone through a period since last summer in which a lot of militants have been eliminated, and yet there are more. And a lot flying of foreign militants, of course, I believe, are still around Pakistan, who have been infiltrating gradually over the last 5 years at least. And so there will be more violence. I'm not sure what they're waiting for, because I think a lot of them have been keeping quiet, those who've been infiltrating from across. We don't hear so much about Pakistani militants. Most of those killed in the last three years or so have been Kashmiris in the south Kashmir. But I believe there are a lot of foreigners there. So there will be more violence.
Hello.
I don't understand. The question is about the highway closure for 2 days a week. I just don't understand the logic of it. And why? Well, it's the state government which is run by the central government, because it's governor's rule, president's rule.
I have another small question. The present government that we have in the center, it was expected to solve this problem or take the problem towards the better direction. But to common man, it seems it has gone to the worst direction. Particularly what they call, because of the muscular policy of the government. What do you think about it?
I agree with the first part of your question, that things have gone worse. I'm not sure that there is any policy at all, whether muscular policy or anything else. I have written an article a couple of years ago talking about it as a flip-flop rather than a policy. We've been, you know, sometime go to Pakistan and try and drop in on a wedding and try and engage with the Pakistani Prime Minister. Another time say, no, the Huriyat will not be allowed to talk. There is this talk of muscular. In fact, I quoted the then Corps commander in Kashmir last year, about maybe 10 months ago, in an article in which he said there is no change in our operations on the ground. So there was a lot of talk of this muscular policy. But actually, I didn't see it on the ground. The operations have been carrying on the way they've been carrying on. In fact, my sense is that by and large, the army has been relatively sensitive compared with the way it was in the late 90s, when it treated it really as a proxy war, and treated, you know, as a sort of starting point, treated everyone in the valley as a potential enemy.
Fearlessness that you were talking about, I don't think it's a totally Kashmiri trend, and I don't think it's a local issue that we're focusing on in Kashmir. I think that can happen anywhere, anytime. So how would you make a distinction of the historical background which you described to bring them up to this point, or a sort of global difference or change in technology that is more important than the historical and cultural and socio-economic that we dwell upon, which today is fairly irrelevant?
I agree with you in the first part. I don't think the last is irrelevant. But surely I agree that this is a global trend. And I said in the very few words that I said about the millennials, I said that they've been shaped largely by social media, which is of course global. The other thing, of course, the other dimension of global media is that it puts us in echo chambers, much more than media in the past. Social media tends to, and there have been studies that have shown this, that social media gives us the impression that we are globally connected, whereas it actually limits us to people who think like us, or our friends on Facebook, or those who Facebook or these other social media networks treat as our network. These are the ones. The other difference between this generation in Kashmir and elsewhere, and I say this as a nuanced thing, it's only a small difference. As I said, broadly they are very similar to the nihilistic people of this generation. And very early in my presentation, I spoke of the nihilism of this time, of this age. The difference is that they have grown up with a kind of messaging that came to them very, very dynamically and strongly from about 2008 onwards about the situation in Kashmir, as well as the situation and connecting it with the situation of Muslims worldwide. And so they do not, many of them, very many of them, I dare say the majority, in fact, I dare say the large majority of millennials, of teenagers today, do not, of course they reject India, but they also reject Pakistan. They reject the nation state. They also reject democracy. They reject democracy as some kind of Western sazish, some kind of Western conspiracy. And they reject even the nation state as an institution, and the kinds of institutions that we've taken for granted as being good. So it's a very challenging situation, which I don't think millennials in other parts of the world share to that extent, this kind of rejection or nihilism, to the extent that you find in a population such as I think, of course I've not studied that. Sure.
This generation has to deal with it, whatever we have left behind, or whatever you want to say. But they are dealing with it the best they can. So would you think that is fair?
They are dealing with it sometimes with a willingness to die, which I feel is something that I don't feel comfortable with endorsing, but certainly people do what they think is right for them.
So, yeah, I have a question.
Yes.
So after the Pandit exodus, you know, Pandits like went all over the world, did pretty well, and you know, they come back and visit their place in Kashmir. So are they pro-India? Are they against it? Or what's their take now? How are those Kashmiris, how do they look at the situation?
My sense is that broadly speaking, the youth, the young people who live in other countries,
yeah,
from the Pandit community, do not want to return to their roots. I mean, do not want to even visit. Even those who have done well in different parts of the country, like Bangalore or Mumbai, are not interested in going back to their roots, even for a visit. It's the few who live in, those who live in Jammu, which is a very large number, and older Kashmiri Pandits who want to return for a visit. But even they very often do not feel comfortable when they go back. Do not think of it as home.
So do they want Kashmir?
And I'm talking about even those who have a house there,
yeah,
who don't of course go and live in the house because it's been so unused, it's not livable perhaps, but they don't feel comfortable.
Do they have anti-India sentiment?
Sorry?
Anti-India sentiment?
I haven't seen that. But certainly there's a much more global sentiment among many of those who are settled abroad. Yes?